Hi, everyone. Thanks for staying late. So it seems like just from seeing the previous talk, I'm going to be summing things up and taking them one a little step further. My career over about 20 plus years has really been as an AI professional across many, many ventures. A bunch of companies went public. I've personally done around 100 patents related to AI. So I'm deep in the technology. I've advised some films, but most of my work has been ventures in the technology space, among other things, just a bio. I did some work that later became Siri on the iPhone, which you're probably all familiar with. And I've worked with Ray Kurzweil and many of the kind of greats in the field, people like Danny Hillis. I spent some time at MIT in the Media Lab doing research in their college days. And so I've been in the field for a long time. And I've personally built expert systems and neural networks and many different kinds of big data and data mining systems. So I've got my hands in all of this stuff and have a feel for it, both on the technical side and the business side. And so I'm going to talk about kind of the big picture as I see it, but hopefully it'll be interactive if you guys still have any questions after today, we can talk. So first of all, you know, the way I see it, there's kind of three forms of entertainment. And a kind of new one is the third one. So lean back, the passive classic media of, you know, watching a traditional narrative that somebody designed, and you're simply passively consuming that narrative, whether it's a movie, a film, you know, a TV show, an audio recording, you're passively leaning back and going on a journey that somebody else created for you. And then there's lean forward, where you have games, social entertainment, a kind of a new media, and then, you know, emerging VR, AR, MR. MR is mixed reality. So here, lean forward is choice-based media, where, you know, the novelty is that you can make choices. But I think there's a third form, what I call edge-of-seat entertainment, which is kind of halfway in between. These are partially interactive experiences. A live performance is an example, where the audience is part of the performance. There's no way to really separate the audience. The fact of the audience being there is what makes a live performance special. So the audience is part of the experience. But then there's also, you know, we probably remember the choose your own adventure kind of movies. There were some experiments where the audience could vote on an ending. Not super successful, but it is partial choice. What I think is interesting is now what we see with VR is a new form of choose your own adventure media coming out, where, you know, a lot of VR experiences are effectively pre-recorded, but there are different paths that you, the viewer or the participant, can explore. And so this edge-of-seat form of media, which kind of halfway between lean back and lean forward, I think is emerging and is something that's interesting. That's where the hybrid of the machine and the human audience, and also maybe the human actor, a human director or producer, they all come together in this edge-of-seat type of experience. And when I look at opportunities, some of the things that I think we've already talked about today, and some new ones, you know, one is generative AI, where you're using AI to generate or do creative work, to create storylines. This year, there's been a lot of work generating images. You may have seen some of the deep learning work where they're allowing deep neural networks to dream and generate new images that have never been created. They've also been using neural networks to generate music. And, you know, even things like complex music, like Baroque music, for example, like in the style of Bach or other composers. And AI is doing a pretty good job. Also making paintings in the style of other artists. So it's not going to be a very long time before you can take story elements and have AI generate stories. Now, whether these stories will be interesting is another question. But it's already, you know, very close. There's actually a company, I think it's called Vault, which is actually analyzing thousands of story elements in scripts to try to predict the success of a film before it's even been filmed, just from the script itself. So generative AI, being able to take actual story elements and build stories, isn't far away. And it may use feedback, deep learning techniques, and audience feedback to improve these stories. One example is a trailer was just made using Watson for a film about AI. The trailer was actually made using AI to analyze moments in the actual film and then actually automatically edit them together into the optimal trailer for the film. I watched the trailer. It wasn't bad. I think the film is called Morgan, something like this. It's coming out. Artificial characters and objects, we're familiar with this. This has often been used to create crowds or extras, sort of non-lead talent that's synthetically generated. But it's moving. We've seen some resurrection, for example, of dead talent in music videos and film that's coming up. This technology is moving forward, first with animation, but ultimately with the ability to actually resurrect or replicate a human actor. So this is an area, an opportunity for AI. Then we have recognition and augmentation of the environment. So if you have an actor and they're in a green screen type of environment, creating the environment around them synthetically using AI is another opportunity. Whether you're generating a scene in outer space or another planet or a historical event, the holodeck, effectively. So this is another big opportunity, being able to both recognize in an actual environment what's going on, detect the objects and index them for post-production, or generate the objects. And then the ability to dynamically respond in a live setting to the audience. So here, when you take a social game or an immersive VR, AR experience, being able to have AI there effectively sort of curating the experience for the audience, but also using the story elements, the characters, all the resources at its disposal to react, kind of the way, if you remember Dungeons and Dragons, the way the dungeon master would sort of craft the experience interactively with the players. Learning is obviously a big area in AI, and here the opportunity is to learn from what worked, what didn't work, to learn from audience feedback, looking across large numbers of films. In one of my companies, Bottlenose, one of the things we've done is analyzed a large number of films and TV shows, comparing audience reactions before, during, and after release to try to see if we can understand anything from what people say about these films, their sentiment and demographics and other trends, behaviors, whether we can predict or learn how to predict what will make a piece of media more or less successful in a particular demographic. And that's actually been pretty successful for some major studios and shows that we've worked on. And then another big area is measurement and predictive analytics, using AI technologies to not only measure the story elements, the market response, but also to try to make predictions based on this measurement and improve those predictions over time. And if you break these out, kind of what's near term, in analytics and business, we've got a couple opportunities around media indexing and search. There are many companies already doing this, whether they're analyzing the content of video or audio, recognizing the people, the faces, the products, the logos, the places, and then adding metadata to the media so they can be searched but also used in production. So you can say, find me all the shots where a certain thing happened, or a certain person appeared, or a certain object appeared. One example would be looking for continuity errors automatically, for example. Another example would be simply being able to take footage that you have from lots of different cameras, lots of different locations, find the things you need and put them together simply by searching without a human having to actually go through and log all those tapes. And then you have, in the audience measurement arena, sentiment analysis is really, I think, about as good as it's going to get. A human being is about 73% accurate on sentiment analysis. That means humans, if you ask them to rate the sentiment of something, they disagree a fair amount of the time. They agree about 73% of the time, and they disagree quite a bit of time. Machines today, with sentiment analysis, are approaching that level of accuracy. There are companies that will claim their sentiment analysis is more accurate than that, and they're basically lying. Sentiment analysis typically is anywhere between 50% accurate to maybe 70% accurate. So it's still an art. But with some of the new advances at Google in language understanding, we are going to get to the point where machines are as, or maybe even slightly more accurate than humans at sentiment analysis. And that will be quite useful for audience measurement to understand what does the audience really think. Some of the unsolved problems in sentiment analysis right now are sarcasm and irony. Don't you hate it when those kinds of things happen? Machines are not good at that. They're not good at understanding double negatives or slang or innuendo. So that's kind of a frontier where deep learning, I think, can be valuable. When you get into predictive analytics, there's been work done on creative, as I said earlier, trying to, for example, that company Vault, trying to predict if a particular script will result in a successful film. But you can also use predictive analytics for making distribution, monetization, and marketing decisions with something that's already been produced. And we've done a lot of that in some of my companies. Figuring out, for example, what country to release something in and when, which ad campaign to use or which creative to use when you're promoting a piece of media. And then another big area is anti-piracy and copyright protection. Because as somebody was saying, we're in this post-truth era, we're also in the era of more and more effective piracy. And so one of the things that's happening now is, for example, with Facebook Smart Stories, effectively, Facebook's automatically reading other people's news and then creating new news that's Facebook news with Facebook ads. Well, it's only a small step for this to happen with creative. It's only a small step for computers to be able to take ideas out of other pieces of creative and put them together into new creative. And then how are you going to detect if that happened? How are you going to detect if your copyrighted material is being reused in these clever ways? Well, one way to do it is to use AI to do data mining, big data analysis, looking for specific elements or themes. You know, it could be thematic elements from music, or it could be elements from animation or a game that are appearing in knockoffs, and you want to find this. I think there's going to be a use for AI, because humans just simply can't scale to the amount of data that has to be analyzed. And then when you look at production, in the previous talk, there was some discussion about using AI to automate editing and other kinds of post-production decisions. Whether it's for error correction or image processing to improve the visual aspect or the audio track, to animate or fill in the environment, even when you're talking about non-actors. For example, recently there was an animated film where a ton of work was done just to make the water extremely realistic, animated water. The water was a character, if you will, in this film. So to really have a good physics model and have the water react, actually you need some AI to do that. And then in the area of production management, decision support, there's a lot that can be done there in workflow and logic. When you're dealing with a complex production with lots of locations and a large team, figuring out when things are going to go wrong in advance, trying to detect problems before they really become problems, managing the schedule, adjusting the schedule when you have lots of variables. So these things are big opportunities for classic AI. I worked with a company also that automatically produced reels and trailers from video. So it would simply go through the video, identify, using AI algorithms, identify the key points in the media, and then would automatically cut a highlight reel and a trailer from that. And it works very well. So these are kind of the obvious opportunities. Intelligent mixed reality is where things are headed. That's where we combine AR, VR, and mixed reality technologies with AI to create intelligent, immersive experiences for people. And so kind of when I break it out, I kind of divide things up into this table. We've covered a lot of this already, so this is really to sum it up. But I think, you know, there are three major areas where AI is going to play a role: creative, production, and business. And across these three forms of media, lean forward, lean back, and edge of seat. So, you know, we won't go through every cell here because we've just discussed a lot of these opportunities. But, you know, where this goes is kind of myth versus reality. There's a lot of hype right now about AI. I think AI in the Gartner sense is, what's the term, Steve? You know, where it's
the trough of disillusionment.
It's not there yet. It's ahead of that, right? We're going to hit the trough of disillusionment. Right now we're in the peak of the hype, the top of the hype cycle, right? It's shooting up. I think today the Wall Street Journal just said they expect AI to go from an $8 billion to a $40 billion market this year, in 1 year. I don't really believe that, but I think it's great for the AI industry. Yeah.
Also,
Oh, that's a great idea. Okay, so the question is, could you use AI to automatically do content ratings? You know, whether something's G-rated or R-rated, or whether it has violence or sexual language or hate. And absolutely, it's already being done on social media. For example, Facebook and other networks are analyzing video and audio already to detect unwanted content. It wouldn't be very difficult, actually, to take a sample. Let's take 100 or even 1,000 films and simply run deep learning against them and then feed in the ratings that they got. The system will actually learn. That's quite straightforward. It would learn to rate films as well as or better than humans by doing that. But I don't know if that's a very difficult thing to do in terms of the human side of determining the ratings of a film. I see. That's a great idea. I mean, that is a straightforward, doable today idea. That could easily be done. No new technology needed, by the way. So anyway, when I look at the kind of hype versus reality, you know, there's some big myths. First of all, AI is going to displace or replace human actors. No, that's not going to happen. Certainly not for many decades or never. And there's lots of reasons for that. First of all, you know, I'm of the particular school of thought that human consciousness is special. I'm an AI person who doesn't really believe in the full vision of AI. I think that humans are special. I think that we, sentient beings, have capabilities that machines just don't and will not have. That's philosophy, and we can get into that later, but that is my personal belief. Anyway, even if I'm wrong, it's going to be a really long time before Kurzweil's singularity. He thinks it's, you know, 30 years from now, approximately, 20 or 30 years from now, but I think it's really much farther away, because if, in fact, all intelligence reduces to computation, it's probably happening at a much more fundamental level than Kurzweil thinks. Kurzweil thinks it's basically at the neuronal level, but it's probably, if it's happening that way, it's happening on the quantum level, which is many orders of magnitude smaller, which means there's a lot more computation going on in the brain than Kurzweil and folks who are of the neuronal intelligence view believe. Massive difference. Yeah, go ahead. Good point. So the point is, every time humans, every time we make computers do something that is more intelligent, we just then move the bar and redefine intelligence as being beyond that that boundary. Which... they'll never. Leonard Cohen says they'll never ever reach the moon, at least not the one they're after. I think this is great. You know, the other way of looking at it is, every time our civilization invents a fundamental new technology, we then start interpreting everything in that way. For example, when clocks were invented, physics started to think that the whole world was a clock. And so we had Newtonian physics, right? And then we developed quantum technologies. You know, then we thought everything was a big quantum computer. With AI, now we're starting to think, well, maybe the universe is a big artificial intelligence. Maybe it's all virtual reality. So we take our latest technology and then we kind of map our entire reality into that and use it as a metaphor. So there's probably something after AI. We'll probably think the universe is that when it comes out. So AI isn't going to displace the human element. I think the human element is actually special. We have capabilities that are unique. We have intuition. We have leaps of insight. We have spiritual insight. Sometimes, you know, there are famous mathematicians like Ramanujan who had revelations from somewhere else. These things are, you know, probably not going to happen in AI. But some of the great works of art came about that way. And by the way, everybody should go see a fantastic film called Touched by Fire, if you haven't seen it, about bipolar geniuses in the arts. It's one of the best films of the year. Nobody's talking about it. You should see it. Because that talks a lot about what I'm talking about, this kind of genius that can't really be computed or even understood. So I don't think the entertainment apocalypse is around the corner. I don't think that AI is a bad thing for humans. I think actually it's really going to augment us. It's going to enable us to free our creativity to do what we're made for, rather than to try to be more like machines. A lot of people right now are thinking about AI as you know, either replacing us or as us and the whole world becoming like a computer. And I think it's the opposite. I think that these technologies were designed to free us. Right now, we don't probably see that. Most of us are probably realizing that while these technologies were supposed to free us, we're spending more and more of our time maintaining the technologies. That's not really freedom, but that will change. That will change. AI will start to be used to actually take away some of this rote, you know, filtering our email, you know, organizing files, this kind of work that we all have to do, bug fixing, maintaining our Gmail account, all this crap that we have to do. That will go away and will free up a lot of our time. So where will the displacement happen? The displacement will happen in any process that is repeatedly predictable, where by analyzing lots of instances of that process, you could make accurate predictions. For example, marketing decisions or distribution decisions. Those decisions are scientific, they're objective. You can study them, you can look at the data, and you can make machines that can optimize that. For example, advertising networks all work this way now, and that's proof that it works. So those types of rote, repeatable things are going to be replaced. Lower level rote decisions will be replaced. But the higher levels of creativity will not be replaced. And that's why the creative industry is always going to have a very important role. Thanks.
Thank you, Nova. I think we got time for a couple questions. But I would like your comment on, alluding to Peter Drucker's thinking, effectiveness should be a human pursuit while efficiency should be delegated to machines.
Exactly. That's my, Peter Drucker's my grandfather.
Great. So question?
Sure, questions.
Go ahead.
So I've been studying the concept of virtualizing one's life into a construct about 15 years, 20 years. And everyone seems to have a consensus now that this will happen, that this is kind of our destiny to create technology that will allow us to live on beyond our mortal coil.
Yeah, I can repeat the question too. I hear him. Yeah.
From your perspective, other than just people voluntarily contributing milestones in their life and minutiae of their existence into Facebook that will be mined later in order to create a believable construct, to what degree does the actual neurological constitution of our meat suit that hosts our personality and our real life construct can be sampled or digitized and or inquired from to govern the development and behavior of such a construct later, rather
yeah,
than
I mean,
just
it's a
factual
very
base.
Deep question. So, you know, there are people who believe that we'll be able to do brain uploads and that we'll live forever in a kind of software version of ourselves. The question is, will that really be us? Or will that be another person or a simulated person? The difference between simulation and the thing that you're simulating is a very subtle difference. And you know, this gets to kind of the essential debate in AI. That's what you're really getting at. So here's my view on it. And I can't claim that I have the definitive answer. I just have my opinion having worked with this stuff for a long time. We will be able to make simulations. If you have enough data, you'll be able to make simulations that can even vary, almost like a jazz musician could vary from a theme. So if you take a person's life stream from social media and you had really good software, you might be able to make a virtual avatar of that person that would respond and interact in a way that would be similar to that person and could be fairly convincing. And this gets to the Turing test and also Searle's Chinese Room. These are famous questions. Would that avatar really know who they were? Would they really be a sentient being? Would they really be that person? Would they be different? What's the boundary? How many memories do they have or be missing for this boundary to change? What is it that really makes a person a person?
And we'll leave it on that provocative question. Thank
you,
Nova.
There were some other questions. We can do it after.
Right, yeah. Absolutely. Thank you very much, Nova. Great presentation.